Good morning. You'll probably see that I put up a video overnight last night that was a review of the sort of holiday musical movie spectacle in the US called Wicked. And I'm not a huge movie buff, and I'm not really a musical buff, but I got an invitation to see this movie, and as it turns out, it really helped solidify and reaffirm a lot of my recent research tracks on the scaffolding that I'm building around Sufi illuminationism and quantum potential and recursion and the human potential movement. And so you'll see that. And I was a little shocked. I uploaded it last night and then I got up this morning. And then there were just several really crap comments. And so I put like a note there that if you feel the need to leave, racist, sexist, homophobic, anti-Semitic comments on my thing, you will be deleted. So there's that. This is not a free-for-all. And but it got me to thinking really about in the film, which is based on a Broadway musical, which is based on a book that was written in the 90s by this guy Gregory Maguire. The book Wicked was not written by L. Frank Baum. It was written by a totally different person. So I don't know if that was lost on the person who left those comments. But like once you have the lens of the reality tunnel, which again, I'm saying I'm in my own reality tunnel, I'm not saying I'm outside, but once you have the metacognition to look, you can always see in people's comments, the comments they leave, it's a reflection of their own inner state. It's their own inner state. And in the film, one of the key things is the Wicked Witch of the West actually wicked? And then what is her backstory? And spoiler alert, if you haven't seen the film and you want to and you don't know what the plot, like pause now and step out of the room. But he essentially the Wizard of Oz is a shyster and he lures Elphaba, who is the main character, to the Emerald City to essentially use her psychic talents for his own empire-building enterprises, and expects her to sit with the program, and then she becomes enemy number one when she has principles of her own and doesn't go with his empire-building program, and then uses her own human potential power to claim her consciousness as a quantum creator and takes off on the broom, and then part two will happen next holiday season to make some more money for movie producers. And so in this, essentially the wizard says several times in the movie, the best way to bring people together, and again, the bringing people together I read as coherence, which is something Joseph Gonzalez has spoken of repeatedly, is this entrainment and this collective resonance, the power of having people entrained. The best way to entrain people to bring them together is to give them a good enemy, right? And that is who Elphaba becomes, is the good enemy. And so in that, I initially talk about how I think maybe the threat of AI is the good enemy to usher in gamified token engineering under the guise of UBI and community currency and time banking in these smart charter cities. And I also say maybe, I'm trying to set outside the judgment of that, like if that's good or if that's bad, because for some people it might be acceptable. For some people, it would be unacceptable. I kind of say, for if you're someone who identifies with a pampered labradoodle and you're lucky enough to get into the lovely, spacious home of, a family in a gated golf community, you might be perfectly fine being a house pet. Or you may be, a beaten up hunting dog living under the porch, in a cold winter, and that would not be good. But then you also may be a coyote person who would never want to be domesticated. And then that's all. So there's these different scenarios, right? And so I'm not saying I appreciate the diversity of the world. I don't necessarily appreciate it when it's like shitty comments on my blogs. But in general, in the abstract, I do appreciate that people have a right to exist in different ways, just maybe not in my space. And yeah, so that's how it is. And so in the vein of the deep reality tunnel and managed consciousness, because my interpretation of the film is essentially Elphaba reaching sort of the eighth circuit of the Robert Anton Wilson, Timothy Leary co-creator with the quantum field, and claiming her power, which is her consciousness, as exemplified by a levitating broom, and then going against the program. And then the next story will be the consequences of that. So that's claiming your consciousness. At this point, again, there's these two routes, at least two, but I see a diversion of people who are focused on materialism and material reality and spiritual, psychic, informational reality, which is immaterial. And again, not good, not bad, just be aware of the choice that you're making. I'm much more in the side of the immaterial, and consciousness lies there. And so when people are wanting to frame, showing up and wanting to frame this film Wicked, which again, I spent an hour and 20 minutes offering a pretty insightful analysis, which with what I think is actually at least a handful of pretty sharp, cogent insights that most people are not saying. And you can't actually respond to any of that, but you literally trot out your program, right? And your program is the Federal Reserve and the Jewish banking cartel, right? And what's so funny is that the people who are in there, they actually don't realize it's a program. Like they have no wherewithal to step out and say, oh, wait a minute, maybe this is a limiting frame, right? It's not to say that it's not true, but it's limiting, right? That's where I was when I was in the materialism side, when I was in impact finance and looking at social policy issues. And then eventually I realized, wow, it's a limited framing. This is not going to get me where I need to go. And at this point, you know, in retrospect, I think Jason was not able to follow because Jason was deeply in the program of money. That was what drew his interest. His focus was the history of money, which is kind of in line with these Federal Reserve people. It wasn't, you know, he has a more sophisticated analysis than the average conspiracy person. But again, and we all participate in things that we don't know about because we don't know the bigger picture. But, you know, over the years leading up to the lockdowns, Jason was doing videography for community banking systems and time banking systems and things that were going to merge into the community currency, just as Joseph was involved in things that were going to be leading into the blockchain smart contract gaming space. And then the question is, once you come to an awareness of it, then what do you do? Then it's a choice how you engage with the information moving forward. And so, you know, for me, I was very grateful to Leo for both having been involved in the blockchain space, realized that there was more to the story than was being told on the surface, finding my work and Raul's work, and then unpacking in his own really deep way the tokenization of grassroots economics and Celo, which is really such important work, and I need to get it re-uploaded to my blog so people can enjoy it again because it got disappeared when Roel took his website down. But then Leo evolving into now working in energy work and Eastern medicine and then fascia. And so for understanding that the tokens as a signal in an economic system were not unlike the chi and the prana and the energy in the morphogenesis, in the fascia of how the embryo develops as a signal in this morphogenetic field, which, as I'm coming to understand more and more, seems to be linked to these other information fields that were accessed by ancient people through different kinds of shamanic and philosophical practices. And, you know, ultimately, one of the main disagreements Jason and I had was he had all of this material of me, and he wanted to make a summary of our research, but ultimately he really wanted to make a video about money, the history of money. And I'm like, don't, but you can do that, Jason. That's totally on you to do that if that's what you feel called to do, but don't put my face on it because my face isn't that story. My face is another route. And so it would be inauthentic for you to clip pieces of me and use it to tell your story. If you're going to tell your story, you tell it how you would tell it, right? With your face. That's how it would work. And if we were being honest about it. So I was really frustrated to see these like very limited Federal Reserve comments thrown in to my analysis, not only the Federal Reserve, but the Jewish banking cartel narrative. Because once you see this conspiracy-tainment reality tunnel for what it is, and it is a deep tunnel, it is very, very deep, which again doesn't mean that the facts aren't true, but if you consider what the wizard says, give people a really good enemy and you can do whatever else you want with them behind the scenes because they're focused on that enemy. And so if that's the Bilderbergers or the Rockefellers or the Federal Reserve or the banking cartel, that's where like the Solari spin doctor hangs out, is in those spaces, which doesn't mean that the Federal Reserve doesn't have elements to do with the token engineering. And again, you know, I was looking at the World Bank and the IMF and the social impact finance, but it's not that story they're telling. It's a broader story about, in my opinion, about signals, about interdimensional signaling. And so you can walk into those tunnels, but if you're building your own scaffold, walk into a lot of tunnels, see what resonates with you, and then start to pull your pieces together in your own independent scaffold. Don't simply keep walking deeper and deeper into a tunnel that's provided for you, because it's probably been provided for you for a reason. Because yeah, they're gonna turn around and offer you a participatory, libertarian, conservative Christian UBI community currencies, right? So that you can do good works and work in the moral economy. But it's not going to be the ESG kind. It's going to be our kind, right? Because they're managing the narrative. And so I think back to when I was still doing interviews at the sort of early phase of the lockdowns. And I was on that higher side chats thing with that guy, Greg, and, you know, who I went sideways with for his support of the crypto space. And again, he was limited. He couldn't process his reality tunnel because he was aligned with the crypto people, which is an energetic hold. So he couldn't know that crypto is actually about biophysics and autopoiesis and coordinating holons of community currency based consciousness tissues in a larger superorganism. Like that, he wasn't going there because he was in the conspiracy field. And for the longest time, the only reason I really did the interview was someone was like, oh no, he's a good one, you can do that interview. And I was like, okay. But later on I realized really it's not worth my time to do anybody else's interviews because nobody really is in alignment with how I think. For better or for worse, that's just, it is how it is. But in that, early in the conversation, I was talking about, I was still in the material side, right? I hadn't gotten to the consciousness part and the fascia part and the quantum field part. And he's like, well, this is fascinating about these social impact bonds and the kids and the iPads and the technology and the surveillance play tables. Like, how is it that you know this? Because I have all of these guests, right? All of these guests who are steeped in conspiracy theory. They've been doing it for decades, right? And they don't see it. They can't see it. And at the time, I didn't have the frame of a reality tunnel. They can't see it. They could put it right in front of their face. Just like with, you know, Stu, right in front of his face, the Catherine says, well, Bitcoin was hijacked, but it could be a good payment processing system. I'm not going to tell you about Andreessen Horowitz and their plans with Ocean Protocol for machine-to-machine token trading. That's the payments, not you buying potato chips. I'm not going to talk about that part. And maybe I don't even know that part because I'm not incentivized to know that part, right? I'm not going to, if you're in that tunnel, it's like a bedtime story and it's comforting. It's like, once upon a time, there was Jekyll Island, right? And they don't say, well, once upon a time, there was Bretton Woods and FDR, who is kind of behind setting up the world banking system that will run the impact bonds. He was guided by a mystical Russian guru, theosophist, you know? And they're like, wait a minute, I didn't know that story, right? Like, oh, there's some consciousness stuff going on here with the World Bank. Oh, structural adjustment might be bodywork. Oh, you know, the signal coordinating and community currencies might be related to building the Gaia fascia, right? And again, this is my take. And I'm not saying I have the right take, But you're not going to find me at this stage running around on other people's YouTube channels or Rumble channels, because everybody's over there, or their Odyssey channels, and going, no, 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 you're doing it wrong. Because I did that for a while. I was like, wait, but you're not talking about social impact finance and cybernetics. So if you're not talking about that, you're missing a whole lot of stuff. You know, Catherine, you're missing a whole lot of stuff not talking about engineer token engineering and game mechanics. You're missing it, right? Because there's no incentive to know that. Everybody's telling you a good night story. And so the people showing up on my comment section today with Wicked, which wasn't even written by L. Frank Baum, but some other guy in the 90s, they want to tell me about the banking cartel. Right? Don't you know? Why are you not talking about that? I'm not doing that anymore. It's useless. We're dealing with memetics. We're dealing with mind viruses. So if you want to show up and you want to offer something into the conversation that expands upon, or maybe say, I hear you, you're seeing it like this, but have you considered something, not that some trite story, right? Because those stories are archetypes. Those stories are deeply embedded blueprints. And I am so glad that I didn't come in that conspiracy door, because it's hard to disentangle from that. Like, it's a web, it's a cocoon. It's, you know, it's like a warm sleeping bag with a hot water bottle on a cold 20 degree night in the forest. You want to be in that story because it's comfortable for you. And you don't want to get out of the sleeping bag and go out into the cold, dark place with your flashlight or your headlamp and look for yourself and try to find your own way. You want to be with others that you resonate with, that you have coherence with, and stay there. And I get it. That's how humans are. We're social creatures. We're creatures of story. So not to throw shades on the people in the warm water bottle sleeping bag, you can be there. But if you're over here, you're over here because maybe you're finding that not terribly satisfying anymore. And I'm offering you this other option, which is pop in over here, see what resonates, pop in other places, look for new things, look for novelty, see where it might fit into your lens. And then, yeah, if you have a lens that's somewhat related, that's not trite old conspiracy theory stuff, well then, hey, pop on over and like tell me about it, right? But I want it to come from you. I don't want it to come from some other influencer, because I don't really give a shit about other influencers at this point. It's not anything I care about. I'm interested in econophysics and biophysics and boundary crossing into infospace and quantum potential. And that's where I've moved through. And you don't have to care about that. You don't. Like, I'm not really that invested that you're, like, cheering me on from the sidelines or whatever. I'm just going to do it anyway because I'm built to do it. And just like, you know, I came in the door of the people canceling the school board meetings from Dell Computers and these philanthropies and harming low-income marginalized communities with technology and going and being like, Elphaba, you know, this is not right. There's something wrong. There's something wrong with the animals, right? There's something wrong with what's happening to the children in the public schools. There's something wrong. And it was from my heart space. It wasn't because I went on a podcast and listened to somebody, or I listened to NPR and they told me. Because if I was listening to NPR, whatever the hell they told me would be the opposite of what actually I should be doing. So yeah, lift up your own lantern. Find your own superpowers. For Elphaba, it was levitation, right? And I think that levitation, again, is claiming your own consciousness. I won't say I'm that evolved. I'm not really that evolved. I stumble all the time. I stumble all the time, but I do have enough distance to see myself stumble and have compassion for myself and then keep going. But I want to keep growing because that's how I'm built. I'm built for the growing part, and I'm built for the metamorphic part. And I can still care about people who aren't on that trajectory. I don't look down on people if you're staying where you are, but you can't actually leave inappropriate comments on my videos. You just can't. So I'm going out for the day. That is my public service announcement for the day. Again, claim your own consciousness. beware of people who will give you a good enemy to focus on and tell you a bedtime story that will keep you comfortable and cozy in your sleeping bag, unless you want to be there. And if so, okay, you do you. And I hope y'all have a good day.